But first, we continue our series, A Place in the World. Last night, we reported on a group of young men with autism who have moved out of their childhood homes in a first step toward living independently, all except the man on the lower right, whose level of disability makes the prospect of achieving a rewarding adulthood much more complicated. John Donvan has part two of our report.
His name is Matt Resnik, and without knowing it, he has helped change the face of autism in his hometown, Phoenix, Arizona, and not just because he produces a line of baked goods, Smile Biscotti, which are for sale all over the city, even here at Pete's Coffee at Phoenix International Airport. Matt is literally the face of Smile Biscotti, where the ads quite deliberately mention that he has autism.
Let's go, Matt. Let's go deliver.
Indeed, he does. Go back a few minutes earlier to when we first started taping his delivery of biscotti, and his autistic nature is more than evident.
All right, Matt, stop. We're not going to look at the camera. Look straight ahead. Matt, look where we're going. Come on, look at me. Look at Dad. All right, no more pictures. Come on.
That's his dad with him, Rob Resnik. And the reason we did not formally interview Matt himself is that he cannot do a television interview.
So how are you today?
How are you?
I'm magnificent.
Good, good.
He lacks the language skills for that.
Say something.
Please enjoy biscotti.
Which is a key reason you don't see many stories about people like him in the media. Moreover, without his dad guiding him, Matt would get lost here in a hurry. It's why he still lives at home, a grown man, with parents who are no longer young, and a mother who represents his closest connection to anyone. You can see that so easily, what's between them. But there is another side to this connection. It's knowing that it may never be duplicated, and that no one else may ever have Matt's back like this.
I love you. I love you. I do worry about Matt. I worry because he's so trusting and so vulnerable. I worry about who's going to be in his home or help him, and who's going to understand him and all his idiosyncrasies. And will I be there?
Let's scoot over here, okay, sweetie?
And how Denise has responded to that worry, one that is shared by parents of all children facing such challenges, it's left its mark, and not just in her house, but in a much bigger way. Although changing the world was the farthest thing from her mind back when Matt was first diagnosed with autism in the early 1990s. Then the mission looked like this.
You ride a bicycle.
He was going to be one of those kids who recovered from his autism. I was sure of it. I was going to make sure that that happened.
And here's what that meant.
Immediately after Matt's diagnosis, I poured my heart and soul in every waking hour into making sure that we were going to provide Matt 40 hours of one-on-one therapy every week, then artfully integrate speech therapy and art therapy and writing therapy.
Denise also followed the path taken by many other parents before her in other times and places, helping to launch an organization, the Southwest Autism Research and Resource Center, SARC for short.
This is our classroom play area, and this is where a lot of learning takes place.
Which would bring about, she hoped, the rescue she was praying for. That, essentially, was the mission back then.
We do our research right here.
SARC even launched its own scientific research center and studied and developed autism-specific curricula. It was an all-out campaign that lasted years. The only thing was, Matt did not recover from autism. The available therapies can lead to dramatically different results in different people, and in Matt's case, he did make strides. He learned to bike and to hike and to read some words and multiply numbers in his head, which came in handy when he helped his mom bake. But some things got worse, like his eating habits, chewing on things that were not food.
He would eat things that were not edible. In a year, he chewed through 132 shirts.
Nor did Matt ever learn to recognize danger in the usual sense. Even now, he wouldn't know what to do if, say, something in the oven caught fire.
No way.
And his language still has serious limits. He has never in his life asked a question or put together a spoken sentence of his own making.
What's next on your schedule?
Watch DVD.
Okay.
He never could talk the way he could sing.
Secure the fancy's all liberty.
Even back then, when Denise was still counting on this little kid outgrowing the challenges to his having a place of his own in the world out there.
The United States of America.
So what are you watching?
And over time, Denise came to the realization that it was the world out there that would have to change if Matt was to be safe and supported when his mom and dad were gone. Accepting that reality, in time, Denise shifted Sark's mission in a new direction.
For the last 2 decades, I have poured my heart and soul into trying to build a community with a lot of other people and trying to achieve a vision.
And when you say community, you don't just mean a community of the people directly affected by autism.
Oh, I mean a broader community.
Everybody.
Right.
And it is why Phoenix, Arizona, Sark's hometown, may be the most autism-aware, autism-friendly metropolis in the world. One in which everywhere Denise pointed when we rode the light rail through downtown together, there was a business employing autistic people.
And this is CVS Pharmacy.
Or a school with classes designed with autism in mind.
You can see ASU.
Or research centers investigating treatments.
St. Joseph's Hospital and Medical Center.
Sark now has literally dozens and dozens of private and public partners energized about supporting autism in real ways, and not just with money, but with jobs, access, and housing. Some of it captured in the story we told last night about that pilot program, preparing autistic adults to live on their own and hold jobs. And also, this preschool.
Let me get you in. Oh, gotcha.
Which mixes classes of autistic with non-autistic children. Because, and it's with that mission in mind again, consider what happens when all these kids grow up.
They're inclusive of kids that are different or that have autism or that have disabilities out in the playground. They're future employers, they're future co-workers. So we're not having to teach these kids directly. They're just consumed around people who are different from them.
And that is the big picture that Denise has long had in mind. A world where support does not merely mean paid staff providing services. It means, well, having neighbors who care, having friends.
What people like Matt and others need, and what we need, are communities. Communities that include friends, people to support us, healthcare, jobs, recreation, places of worship, transportation. And to think that a family can go at this alone to build a life for their loved one isn't good enough.
So even if a family had all the money in the world, that having those resources would not be enough to take care of their kid through adulthood and through life.
It would be enough to take care of their kid,
yeah.
But what they may be lacking are friends, because you don't pay your friends.
The next major step, well, it's an empty lot right now, but it won't always be.
So when you come out here, do you, you know, it's an empty field now, but can you see it?
I can see it.
Yeah?
I can see it, I can feel it, and it's going to happen. And it's something I've been dreaming about almost since the first day the school bus arrived for Matt.
This is the future site of an apartment complex to be called First Place, which will look like this and will be supported through a collaboration among more than 75 charitable, private, and public groups, creating a neighborhood of people of varying levels of ability and disability with more or less support as needed. It is where Matt will live too.
This is going to be his home. It may not be his home forever,
But
aptly named, it's going to be his home when he leaves our family home.
His first place away from home.
It is.
Groundbreaking is set for later this year. For now, though, Matt still has the two best support people anyone could ask for, his mom and dad, who are helping to keep the biscotti business on track, one that employs several other people on the autism spectrum. But when it's just the three of them together, that's when the question of Matt's future comes back into focus, with the hope that 10, 30, 40 years from now, he'll have a whole community by his side and at his back, taking in the song and caring what he has to say.
And I'm free. Free falling.
For the NewsHour, I'm John Donvan in Phoenix.